next on Unsolved Mysteries. A Texas man gets life for a robbery that five witnesses say he did not commit. And now even the prosecutor has doubts. When a young computer whiz hacks into a military computer, authorities fear that he's a spy. A woman learns that the man she married is a convicted con artist. He also has a nasty temper and a taste for violence. And Sharon Kinney was a woman who knew what she wanted, sex and money, and she was willing to kill for it. These are stories with intriguing secrets and surprising revelations, so stick around. I'm Dennis Farina, and for the next hour, this is Unsolved Mysteries. Garland, Texas, 7 p.m. A man enters a gas station and draws a gun on the attendant who is closing up for the day.
When he first came in the door, he was shaking the gun at me, telling me he'd kill me, goddamn, he'd kill me. And then I realized it was all for real.
The attendant, Doyle, does not want his last name used because his eyewitness testimony put a man in prison for life.
And if you had a 45 stuck in your face and somebody was telling you they was gonna kill you, it's something that stick with you the rest of your life and you never forget the person that does it.
Doyle later identified his attacker as Michael Scott Martin, a 26-year-old welder. Five other witnesses, however, swear that Martin could not have possibly robbed that gas station because he spent the whole day at his home 70 miles away.
This is ridiculous. I'm at my house in Fort Worth working on a motorcycle, and they're saying I'm robbing a gas station in Garland. And I've never robbed anything in my life, and I never will.
Michael Martin, Detective Dennis Wheatley.
Based on Doyle's testimony, Martin was convicted of armed robbery.
Need you to place your hands on that wall for me.
Because of a previous arrest, he is sentenced to life in prison. But Martin insists he's innocent.
I'm about to the point of giving up. I am innocent. I've gone all the way to the Supreme Court fighting this, and I just keep hoping and praying that there's a way and I'll find it. And one day I'll prove that I didn't rob that gas station.
The case against Michael Martin was based entirely on Doyle's eyewitness identification. There was no physical evidence connecting him to the robbery. No fingerprints were found at the scene, and neither the money nor the gun was ever recovered. Michael Martin had a clean record until he was 26 years old. 7 months before the gas station robbery, he was arrested after an incident at a supermarket. Martin and a friend had been drinking and were seen eating food taken from the store's shelves.
Contact the police.
We're not staying anywhere. Here's your lousy money.
When the manager threatened to call the police, Michael Martin says he panicked.
I don't really know why I pulled the knife. I guess it was just a desire to get out of the door.
Get out of here.
I'm drunk, I'm feeling a little crazy. I'd been hassling with this manager and I was tired of it. I fired it well over their heads. I wasn't meaning to hurt anybody. It was just an adolescent stunt that I never should have. You know, I was 26 years old then. I shouldn't have been out shooting up the town like that. It just didn't make any sense.
I wouldn't call placing knives or shooting at people a prank. It's a pretty serious offense.
You don't expect somebody to get out outrageously angry when they're asked to pay for something that they're eating inside a store. I don't think that should lead to the kind of reaction on Michael's part that he obviously had. There was testimony that he was intoxicated at the time. But still, an intoxicated person who would go to that lengths to avoid paying for a Polish sausage, you have to wonder about it.
Martin pleaded guilty to assault with a deadly weapon. He was fined and given 4 years probation. Then, 2 weeks after Martin's probation began, the gas station was robbed. The gunman took $400 and fled the scene in a car stolen from the attendant. At 7:15 p.m., police spotted the stolen car outside a nearby apartment where Michael Martin had lived only a month before. 7:25 p.m., Detective Wheatley, who'd investigated the supermarket incident, claims that he saw Michael Martin in his blue Camaro 3 blocks from the gas station.
He looked at me, and I looked at him and knew him from the previous offense. And I said to myself, that's Michael Scott Martin. He came close enough to me that I could have reached over the top of my motorcycle and slapped him. Noel, I'm going to show you a stack of photographs here. What I'd like you to do is look through them and see if you see an individual in here that you recognize.
Okay.
Wheatley asked to be assigned to the robbery case. The following day, he showed the victim, Doyle, a series of mugshots.
He's the type of witness that you wish you had on every case. His intensity, his quick reaction to picking Michael Scott Martin made him a good witness.
Michael Martin was arrested, charged with aggravated armed robbery, and held without bail.
It's a depressing experience, but I felt like I would prove my innocence. I mean, I didn't rob this gas station. I knew I didn't rob this gas station. I thought I had sufficient proof in just having people that knew where I was at.
Martin claims that he was at Lake Worth, 70 miles from Garland at the time of the robbery. 5 separate witnesses, 3 who barely knew Martin, backed up his claim.
The day that they say the robbery happened, I worked on my car and he worked on his motorcycle. And other than about 2 hours that afternoon when he ran for parts, he was here at all times, from the time he got up in the morning to the time he went to bed at night.
He was there with me and with George at the time he was accused of robbing this gas station. He just couldn't have done it. He just didn't do it.
When I left my house, it was after 6, before 6:30, and I saw Mike out in front of his house. I was surprised to see that Mike was arrested because I knew I'd seen him so close to the time that the crime was supposed to be committed.
It takes well over an hour to drive from here to Garland. I saw him around 6 o'clock, and there's no way he would have had time to leave and commit this crime by 7 o'clock.
It's 7 o'clock Saturday night. I remember it real well because there was a television show that I wanted to catch. It was Battlestar Galactica, so I made sure that at 7 o'clock I was there in front of the television.
Mike, show start.
And Mike came in and watched the show with me. How could he have been at my house at 7 p.m. if he was in Garland at 7 p.m., 75, 80 miles away?
The trial was held in the same courtroom where Michael Martin had been sentenced to probation. The turning point came when his supermarket conviction was admitted into the court record, possibly swaying the jury against Michael Martin.
I don't know if we could have gotten a guilty conviction in the second offense if the jury had not known about the first offense. I think that works great psychological influence on the jury. I know that my witnesses were positive. I also know that the defense witnesses were positive. And it was one of those cases back then when I simply had to put on the case and let the jury make their decision. That's what our system's all about.
It took the jury only 15 minutes to find Michael Martin guilty of aggravated assault with a deadly weapon and aggravated robbery. They gave him the maximum sentence possible under the law.
I have to do 20 flat years because I supposedly took $400 from this gas station. I don't think I got a fair trial.
Even the prosecutor is troubled by the case. Could the jury have put an innocent man behind bars?
It always bothered me that we were not able to come up with the clincher. There were no fingerprints found at the scene or on the getaway car, no recovery of the stolen items. There was nothing that conclusively tied Michael Martin to the commission of the offense besides the eyewitness testimony. And it's for that reason that I think I always had a little doubt left in my mind about this case.
I'm still sure that I put the right man in jail. There's no doubt in my mind then, and there is no doubt in my mind now.
Why would five people, three of whom barely knew him, why would they lie in a court of law to protect him?
Back at the time, I leaned toward thinking that Michael Martin was guilty. And today, in retrospect, I simply don't know. I thought my witness was positive, but also the witnesses who testified for Michael Martin were positive that they were with him at the time of the offense 70 miles away. So it's one of those that I guess we'll never know the true answer to.
I've never stopped trying to prove my innocence because I don't know what else I have right now. I can really appreciate what freedom is. Before I came here, it was a big abstract, you know? It was always there. When it's taken away, you really appreciate it. I want what I lost, what I feel I had taken from me.
Update. Michael Martin has been released from prison, but will remain on parole for the rest of his life. He is still determined to clear his name. So if you have any information about the gas station robbery in Garland, Texas, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, she's called the Black Widow of Missouri, the baddest of bad girls. Have you seen Sharon Kinney? Fast, loose, and ruthless. Sharon Kinney was the very definition of a bad girl. And she would soon be wanted for murder. Independence, Missouri.
Is this Kinney?
A sheriff's deputy is summoned by a distraught Sharon Kinney, then only 20 years old.
Calm down, Miss Kinney, calm down. Where is he?
He's in the back bedroom.
Sharon's husband, James, has been shot once in the back of the head. A .22 caliber target pistol is in plain sight. There is no sign of a struggle. And 25-year-old James Kinney dies on the way to the hospital.
Mrs. Kinney, I realize how difficult this time is for you, but if you could tell us exactly what happened.
The next day, Kinney was interviewed by detectives.
James was cleaning his gun in the bedroom.
Her grief was convincing, her bizarre story believable. She said that James was in the bedroom cleaning his pistol while she was in the bathroom putting on makeup. James, she said, lay down for a nap. Dana, their 2-year-old daughter, wandered into the bedroom.
Daddy, show me this.
Show me this. Show me this.
Yes.
And then I heard the shot. And I ran in there, and there he was, just lying there.
I thought she was credible, and she was very distraught, and it was very genuine. And then, for me, it became a problem of if the little girl did it, what a shame, what a terrible tragedy.
Even though Kinney herself seemed credible, police did have trouble believing a 2-year-old had fired the fatal shot.
We were skeptical about the little girl. But unfortunately, they were the only witnesses there. There was no one else to talk to except Sharon Kinney.
More than he shot it.
All they could do was just buy into whatever it was Sharon was telling them, and she was very convincing. And that's not to their discredit. When Sharon told you something, you were just expected to believe. She was that good.
The insurance company bought into Sharon Kinney's story as well. She collected on policies totaling more than $200,000. Kinney paid cash for a new convertible and allegedly had an affair with the married man that she had bought it from. And Sharon Kinney was just getting started.
She wanted the salesman to leave his wife and his children and take care of her.
Hi, sweetie.
She wanted him. In her mind, whatever Sharon wanted, Sharon got.
But the salesman apparently had no intention of leaving his family, even though Kinney told him that she was pregnant. Sharon was determined to separate the car salesman from his wife, permanently.
Hello, Patricia Jones? I'm sorry to have to tell you this, but I have some information about your husband. He's been having an affair with my sister. I'd like to get together with you if I could and talk about this a little more.
Patricia Jones agreed to a meeting. She asked a friend to go with her.
Yeah. I'm going to take a quick ride with her.
Are you sure?
I need to do this.
Okay, just be careful.
Patricia Jones never made it home that night. The next day, Sharon herself volunteered to help in the search.
All right, well, where should we check next?
I don't know.
Kinney got some help from yet another lover, a man named John Boldis. They didn't find Patricia. At least not yet. According to John, Kinney suggested that they end that evening at a popular lover's lane.
It's been a while since we've done this.
It's been too long since we've done this.
Yeah, I think you're right. What?
Do you see that? Oh my God. My friend's wife was wearing a yellow dress just like that yesterday.
She makes this young man get out and look. And it scares the living bejesus out of him, because there is the salesman's wife laying shot and dead in the grass.
We gotta go to the police.
Why?
Because she's dead. We have to go to the police.
All right, fine. Go to the police, but you know what? Drop me off at home first, and don't tell him I was with you.
Straight away, he told him, well, I wasn't out here by myself. I was out with Mrs. Sharon Kinney. And the name just set off all kinds of bells and whistles in the investigator's head because they remembered her story from just a couple months before that.
Prosecutors wasted no time. Kinney was charged with the murder of Patricia Jones and also of her husband, James. Across Missouri, Sharon Kinney became a household name. The Patricia Jones murder trial was first, and Kinney easily charmed the all-male jury.
Sharon had control of that courtroom. She had control of the jury. She had control of the spectators. Everybody's attention was focused on Sharon Kinney. Even to the point, the second day of the trial, after the trial started, Sharon came moseying in late, fashionably late, probably in her mind. The trial went on for about 10 days. The jury came back after deliberating only an hour and a half for the verdict of not guilty. The courtroom erupted in cheers. Jurors came out of the juror box and went over and got Sharon's autograph. People in the audience came and got Sharon's autograph.
But Kinney's trials were not over. She still faced the charge of killing her husband, James. The star witness for that prosecution was none other than Sharon's former boyfriend, John Boldis. He testified that Sharon had once offered him $1,000 to kill her husband. This time, Kinney was convicted and sentenced to life in prison. But the Missouri Supreme Court overturned her conviction on a legal technicality. Sharon Kinney was released on a $25,000 bond pending retrial.
Does that look too short for you on that side?
Sharon soon had a new lover, a man who listed his occupations as a hairdresser and a blacksmith.
Well, you know, I'm full of surprises.
They fall in love, decide that what they're going to do is they're going to go to Mexico on a pre-marriage honeymoon.
Frankie, I'm so excited. I've never been to Mexico before. I want
margaritas,
enchiladas.
Once in Mexico, a series of misadventures landed Sharon in a seedy hotel room with yet another man. When he turned up dead, she told police that she had acted in self-defense. Mexican authorities didn't believe her story. Kinney was convicted of murder and sentenced to 13 years in prison. However, after serving less than five, she escaped by squeezing through an unguarded window, and she hasn't been seen since.
Sharon Kinney could have been somebody. She could have used her intelligence and used her wit. She could have been a pioneer woman in politics or in academia or anything. But she chose it to go the other way around. She let greed, avarice, and promiscuity rule her life.
Some say that Kinney is still alive and well. She may have stayed in Mexico, or she may have gone to Alaska, where she has relatives. This photograph shows how Kinney might look today. Among Kinney's belongings found in Mexico was the .22 caliber target pistol that killed Patricia Jones. But because of double jeopardy laws, Kinney cannot be retried for that crime. If you have any information about Sharon Kinney, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a woman was losing her battle with cancer until she touched the headstone of a young woman who died more than 30 years earlier. Lourdes, Fatima, and Medjugorje. Every year, millions make the pilgrimage, hoping to be healed. Now, there's a new Mecca for miracles that's much closer to home. It's the tomb of a young girl in Louisiana named Charlene Richard. Many people say that even from the grave, she has the power to heal. Donald Ledger is a believer. A sergeant in the Army, he had a fall that shattered both of his heels. Doctors doubted that he would ever walk again. And then Donald started praying to Charlene. To everyone's surprise, he didn't just walk, he started running.
Without the intercession of Charlene, I feel that I would not be able to walk. I truly believe this. I believe in miracles. I do.
Richard, Louisiana. It was 1959. Charlene had leukemia and was in great pain. Yet, when Father Brennan found the courage to tell her that she was dying, it was she who comforted him.
Father Brennan, when I see the Blessed Mother, I'll tell her that you said hello.
Charlene had always believed that one person suffering can save another. And though she was dying, she offered her own pain as redemption for other patients in the hospital.
When the sickness came and the pain came, she grew in crisis. She became great.
Every day for 2 weeks, even as her own time was running out, Charlene prayed for others.
I will be gone tomorrow. I want to say goodbye. I will be praying for you.
Charlene died the next day.
I felt a presence in that room of the divine. There was a aura of peace in that room.
Over the years, word spread of Charlene's courage and her saintly ways. People started praying to her and asking her to intercede for them with God. Each year, more and more people say they've experienced Charlene's power to heal. One of them is Tara Roy, who was diagnosed with colon cancer when she was just 21.
She was diagnosed with a Duke's Class C stage 3 carcinoma. And I've done enough research and reading about it to where I know that you don't come back from those.
Tara started heavy doses of chemotherapy.
I didn't want this to interfere with my life, but I didn't want it to, like, totally take over, you know, and dictate what I would do and how I would do it. I just wanted to be a college student and go to class and do my job.
But every day, she felt worse. Tara and her parents started making frequent trips to Charlene's grave. On their last trip, Tara was so sick that she thought she might die within weeks.
With the cumulative chemotherapy kicking in real strong, we almost turned around and came home.
I didn't want to go. I felt terrible. It was probably one of those days that I just didn't want to do anything. Laying in bed was a challenge. Deep down, I wanted to go to the grave that day. I just didn't physically feel up to it at all.
Tara knelt by Charlene's grave as usual. And then some impulse inspired her to do something that she had never done before. With her fingers, she traced the letters of Charlene's name.
And in about 20 seconds, she turned around and she was transformed. And when I saw her, I was stunned.
I felt like, you know, a lot had been lifted right then, like just like a weight off my shoulder was lifted right then.
Pop, I'm gonna be okay.
I just felt that I definitely would be healthy again and I would beat this.
Tara did beat the cancer. She got back to being a healthy and happy young woman, finished college, and went on to get a master's degree in social work.
I saw the hand of God. I saw what I needed to see that day. We saw a miracle, no doubt.
Since Charlene Richards' death, locals have petitioned the Catholic Church to canonize her as a saint. Regardless of how the church responds, those in need of healing will likely continue to seek the help of Charlene Richard. Coming up, when his charm wears thin and his money runs out, a con man gets violent.
Why are you doing this?
Baltimore, Maryland.
The usual table, please.
Well, this looks very nice.
Well, you're gonna love
when Beth Smith met Sal Oliverio, she had one weak spot. Yeah. Oliverio found it and latched onto it.
Thank you.
Tony, your best champagne.
I was a single mother of two children. Financially, I was very stable. Career-wise, I was very stable. And I guess the only thing that was really missing in that equation was a husband and a father for my children.
You're gorgeous.
Beth was a computer consultant. Oliverio ran a physical therapy business. Beth says that he told her about his distinguished Navy career, including 2 years as a POW in Vietnam.
He can't understand unless you were over there.
He told these war stories to me. He told them to my children. You know, my children thought of him as a war hero.
The only thing I knew was I was not gonna die there.
When he would tell these stories, he would cry. He would literally cry. He would be very believable.
Beth fell in love with the man that Sal Oliverio pretended to be. They were soon married, and Beth quit her own job to run Oliverio's company, which appeared to be in trouble.
The bottom line numbers always showed him in the red, and it was just, you know, amazing.
Sal, could you come in here for a minute?
Yes, dear.
You know, I have been over and over these numbers, and I just don't understand what's going on.
Don't worry about it.
What do you mean, don't worry about it? Where's the money going to come from?
Don't worry about it. I've got some checks coming in.
Sal, what about the quarterly taxes?
You don't understand this business. I'll take care of it. It's not your problem.
Things were not as they appeared to be before we were married at all. In his personality, in his background, it changed. He changed. The true him came out.
The true him was stuffed in a box in the basement. Beth found it just before their third anniversary.
It had written on it, Lexington Correctional Institution. And I'd never seen that before.
Oliverio's past was spelled out in bold headlines. So was his real name, Salvatore Spinato. He had done time in Kentucky for bank fraud and had run business scams for years. One investor alone lost $250,000.
It told me that I was married to someone that was very deceptive, very manipulative, and everything that he told me about what he wanted and who he was a lie.
Beth moved out a few days later. Eventually, she got a divorce.
We still maintained a relationship at that point because he still owed me a significant amount of money, and he was making payments on that. Not consistently and not by court order at all. Just occasionally he would call and say, I have some extra money, and give me a few $100 towards what he owed me.
Several years after the divorce, Beth had to leave town for 10 days. Her boyfriend had his own plans to be away, so she asked Spinato to keep an eye on her 17-year-old son.
Sal, I got a favor to ask.
Sal and my son had a good relationship when we were married and before we were married. They got along well together. And he said that was fine. He would do that.
A couple days after Beth left the country, I got a call out of the blue from Sal. He called me and said that he needed to talk to me right away, that he was very concerned about her son, that he was involved with some drugs.
Yeah, it's drugs. The kid's gonna get in trouble. She's out of the country. I don't know what to do.
He was very concerned about his welfare, his health and well-being. It was his stepson. He said, there's a house that I just bought around the corner. Would I mind just following him there? And he'd give me some more information.
Let me show you what I found.
The club had an electric shock to it. It was a taser weapon. I knew that I was in a real bad situation. I mean, nobody saw me go in. Nobody knew where I was. I knew I was history.
We're gonna kill you. You ain't walking out of here. You ain't never seeing your kids again.
I thought this was about the kid.
You idiot, ain't about him. It's about my wife. She's still my wife, capisce?
I realized that this had nothing to do with her son. The whole purpose in Sal's mind was for me to stop seeing his ex-wife.
Get him.
Greg recognized Sal's accomplice as a man who had come to see him earlier about a house he was selling.
I got your agent's number, and we'll be in touch.
Sure thing.
Thanks.
He mentioned his name, but I didn't remember it. So as he pulled away, I wrote down his license plate number.
Okay, Sal.
I was willing to do anything, say anything, to get out of that house. The whole conversation shifted. You know, he had decided that he was going to let me live, that he wasn't going to kill me.
We're going to go for a little ride. We got to come up with a plan.
Greg had another plan. He went straight to the police. They identified Homer Paul Schaefer, Spinato's accomplice, from the license number Greg wrote down. Schaefer was convicted of multiple crimes and sentenced to 32 years in prison. Spinato was arrested, booked, and then released on bail. But on his scheduled court date, Salvatore Spinato was nowhere to be found.
I think he's a very desperate man. I think he's gone over the edge of what he's done in the past. I think he's a very dangerous person. And if he would do this, what else would he do?
Now he's moved into the realm of manipulating people by using violence. There's no reason to conclude that he won't do it again in the future, especially if he sees from some point of view he's got nothing to lose.
Update. After a 7-month search, Salvatore Spinato was captured in Lewisville, Texas. He was convicted of kidnapping and assault and was sentenced to 25 years in prison. He served his time and has been released. Next, a computer hacker searches for secrets in military and government computers. Is he a spy? Menlo Park, California. We recently told you the story of Kevin Polson, a computer hacker who called himself Dark Dante. Inside his storage locker, authorities found thousands of dollars worth of stolen telephone company equipment. For more than a year, Polson had been accessing sensitive government and military computer programs. A search of his home turned up phone tapping equipment stolen from a communications company. Polson had even taken photographs of himself breaking in and using the equipment at a phone company transmitting station. Inside his storage locker were printouts containing classified military information and the unlisted phone number of the Soviet consulate.
His penetration of the United States Army government computer, his obtaining of a non-published number of the Soviet consulate, gave us grave concern as to how far Polson was going with these criminal acts.
Polson was indicted on 18 felony counts of computer-related crimes. But before his trial, he jumped bail and disappeared. Update. As the result of our broadcast, the FBI received information that Polson was living near Los Angeles.
Polson had some acquaintances in the Los Angeles area. One of them advised us that he had been seen in the not-too-distant past at Hughes Market.
3 weeks later, Polson returned to the supermarket.
I walked past Kevin, and adrenaline was pumping in me. I felt really nervous and didn't want to be let any suspicion onto Kevin that we were on to him.
Brian called the FBI, but Polson left before agents arrived.
Kevin Polson had been seen at the Van Nuys Hughes Market at about 10 or 10:30 in the evening. I decided to surveil the market, thinking Kevin may show up again. At about 10 minutes till midnight, Kevin Polson arrived once Kevin was in the store. I asked the security guard to go find Brian Bridges, the evening manager, so I could tell him that Kevin Polson was in the store.
Believing that Polson would get away again, two store clerks made a daring move.
Security!
A security guard took Polson to a storeroom where he was held until FBI agents arrived.
We found some handcuff keys in his eyeglass cases. During the time that he was in custody, he claimed that his contact lenses were drying out and he had asked for his eyeglass cases to be sent to him. So I'm assuming that he was looking for the handcuff keys.
Polson pleaded guilty to 7 counts of conspiracy, fraud, and intercepting wire communications. He was sentenced to 51 months in federal prison. After serving his time, Kevin Polson became a senior editor for the online service of Wired magazine. Polson also assisted law enforcement, creating a program to find registered sex offenders who have MySpace pages. Over 700 were found, and nearly 500 of them had sexually assaulted children. We're happy to report that Kevin Polson is a bad guy gone good. Mason City, Iowa, 1973. Christy Wismer is 16. Her boyfriend, Dave Carlson, is 18. Their youthful romance is short but sweet. After 6 months together, they break up, only to discover that their romance has consequences that will last a lifetime.
Dave, I need to talk to you.
Sure. What's wrong?
I'm pregnant.
We had broke up a week before I found out that I was pregnant, and all I could think of was, how's Dave gonna handle this? And what about my folks? You know, I just thought it was the end of the world coming.
Now, what the hell is going on with
Christy's father was furious when he found out.
You're 16 and pregnant, and you did it!
This isn't helping anything.
He was taking it very hard and told me that I was just an embarrassment to the family, that he couldn't possibly love me.
To Christy, it seemed the only thing to do was to put the child up for adoption.
Christy, you're almost done. You're almost done.
Christy gave birth to a beautiful and healthy baby girl. But Christy never even got to hold her baby.
They took the baby away right away. After they wheeled me back to my room and put me into the bed, my mother came up and talked to me for a little while, and she asked if I would walk down and look at the baby. She looked so sweet laying there.
She's beautiful.
I knew that I loved her, but I couldn't take her home.
Before the baby was 24 hours old, she was on her way to a new family.
Bless you, Christy.
For decades, Christy lived with bittersweet memories of her romance with Dave. And then she heard from friends that Dave wanted to see her.
I was really nervous about contacting him. I was really glad when I did make the phone call, though, because it seemed like we still, you know, the feelings were still there. And he asked if we could see each other the following night for a date, and we met, and things were still clicking between us.
They fell in love all over again, and the following year, Christy and Dave were married. They knew their happiness would be complete if they could only locate their daughter.
I'm not trying to take the place of her family. I gave up all my rights back then, and I would just like to make myself available for whatever purpose she might have.
I've got to at least attempt to find her, let her know that I didn't give her up for adoption because I didn't want her. I gave her up because of the circumstances.
Update. On the night of our broadcast, one viewer was certain that her daughter-in-law, Katie Jacobs, was the child that Dave and Christy were seeking. She called Katie, who then called us.
Are you my mom for sure?
It sure sounds like it.
Oh my God.
All the clues are in and all the clues fit. I can hardly wait to meet you. Can I meet you?
Me too.
Can I meet you?
Yes.
Oh, that's terrific.
3 weeks later, Christy and Dave welcome Katie into their lives.
How was your flight?
That's good.
You made it in Chicago, huh?
Yeah.
Katie was accompanied by her husband, Rick Jacobs, and their 1.5-year-old daughter, Michaela.
Here I was talking to somebody that was like a major part of my life, but I had never met before. So it's kind of strange. It feels real good because it answers a lot of questions. It just kind of fills something that, you know, wasn't there.
It's nice to be able to think about Katie and be happy and know that everything's okay. She's been good.
I've been hoping for this for 22 years, and it's just so hard to put it into words. You know, finally, you know, my life's complete. I found Katie.
Of course, not all stories end happily. If you have any information about the cases we profiled, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.